A century ago, Australians of all backgrounds saw that flying could change their lives. They glimpsed a future that they might aspire to.
But the planes they went up in seem impossibly frail. I'm going to get as close as I can to what flying once felt like.
This is the first aircraft I've owned that had no fire extinguisher. I said to the engineers, where's the fire extinguisher? They said, you won't need one. I said, what do you mean I won't need one? They said, they burn beautifully.
Thousands of Australians flew first in planes as flimsy and exposed as this Tiger Moth.
So what you need to know is if the engine fails and I say to you, evacuate, get out.
Clear. Okay. Contact.
Are you all set?
Yeah, I do feel pretty nervous. You
feel a few little bumps as we go through the top of the inversion?
Yes, I feel them.
You look down over there.
I said, are you gonna be my girl?
Yeah, I'm just gonna look ahead. It's scary!
The early aeroplanes used in Australia up until the 1930s were primarily made of wood or possibly a metal frame, covered in fabric like linen. They were held together by a whole series of wires that kept them basically really taut and strong, but effectively they were a little bit like flying in a chair.
All right, so your seatbelts are tight. Here we go.
I think I'm ready to be back on the ground. Oh, that was such a thrill. I felt free as a bird. And when we were doing our steep turns and rondelles, I just relaxed right into it. What a thrill, but it's dangerous.
Australian aviation was born in the shadow of World War I. In 1919, Australian Prime Minister Billy Hughes flew from London to Paris for the peace conference. And he met Aussie war pilots fired up about the potential of planes. Hughes proposed the Great Air Race.
10,000 pounds for the first successful flight from London to Australia in a machine manned by Australians.
It was a feat that had never been attempted before. Six Australian crews, all war veterans, set out. Ace fighter pilot Ross Smith and his brother Keith featured in newsreels and documentary reenactments.
G-E-A-O-U. God help all of us.
In open cockpits, behind deafening engines, and with no parachutes, the journey was perilous.
This cold as hell. I'm a silly ass for ever coming on this flight.
Of the six teams, four crashed.
Anxiety felt. Position uncertain.
Australians were horrified and captivated.
There it is, Australia. By Jesus, they're coming up to meet us.
Ross and Keith Smith won.
We made it.
They got the cash prize, knighthoods, and changed the way Australians saw themselves.
Suddenly, that tyranny of distance, that isolation at the arse end of the world, this was overcome. And this made us feel good about ourselves. It made us feel seen. Actually, we were in the world spotlight.
Ironically, the biggest winners of the Great Air Race never flew in it. War pilots Hudson Fysh and Paul McGuinness got the job of surveying the Australian leg of the route.
in a Model T Ford, like this, hey Bob?
Yep.
They took off from Longreach in Queensland. Most of the terrain had never been crossed by car. 51 grueling days later, they arrived in Katherine in the Northern Territory. They were convinced this place needed planes.
The next year, Fish and McGuinness started Qantas. In the 1920s, flying was an exciting distraction for a nation still traumatised by war. Australians grieved for 60,000 dead. They supported 500,000 physically wounded men and countless more damaged minds.
A lot of people were very tolerant with the young flyers. They knew they had a terrible war. They knew they'd risked their lives. They knew they were young, and they knew that they were having trouble settling back to peace, and they put up with the most awful antics.
My father was a pilot in World War I, and we never quite heard too much about that. And he came back to Australia and went into every kind of flying. Just aerial taxis, joyriding, barnstorming, anything he could get.
Restless young men like Horry Miller were the founders of Australian civil aviation.
For the ordinary person, it was nearly unbelievable because people had only just seen cars on the road. So looking up to the sky and seeing something suspended in midair captivated everyone. I don't think there was a single person who didn't look to the skies and wonder what it meant for them and what it meant for the world.
In 1922, the Smith brothers returned to London to go one better than the Great Air Race. They aimed to be the first aviators to circumnavigate the world. Moments after the film ran out, the Vickers crashed. Keith saw the plane go down. Ross died instantly.
Early aviators were courageous, adventurous, incredibly competitive. When their friends are killed, often what you see is a desire to be driven harder and further, to want to survive and achieve, not only for themselves, but for the people who didn't make it.
The Flying Doctor Services have surely provided a mantle of safety for the people of the outback.
One by one, aviators conquered the world's air spaces. By 1928, few frontiers remained, yet no one had ever flown a plane across the Pacific Ocean.
Covering a third of the Earth's surface with few places to refuel, a trans-Pacific flight was considered extremely dangerous.
But Australians Charles Kingsford Smith and Charles Ulm were determined to be first.
Smithy and Ulm went to California with no plane, little money, but plans to fly home. Through its music and movies, America had shared its big dreams with Australians. And it was the richest country in the world.
Smithy and Ulm have a tremendous break. They're introduced to an oil millionaire. And the oil millionaire takes a great shine to Smithy. And he says, I'll buy the plane, gets them the crew, Harry Lyon, who's the navigator, and Jim Warner, who was the wireless operator. And they're both very skilled, and they've been in the US Navy. And they set out. They set out across the Pacific.
Smithy planned to cross the vast ocean in three long hops.
It's not so bad going to Hawaii. The next hop, which is to Fiji, is the dangerous hop. They call it a shot at a dot because Fiji's so small. Will Harry Lyme be able to find it?
They sat on wicker chairs they'd bought at a garden shop, and they'd installed a huge fuel tank between the cabin and the cockpit.
Every now and again you'll feel something smack you in the back of the neck, and you'll know that Harry Lyme had poked a message through to you, telling you how your course was shaping.
Well, they get through these awful storms. They have to fly right through them, mostly, because they're afraid if they climb too much, they will use up too much fuel. And Smithy, he has to use instruments. Can't see a thing out the window. It just shows how very brilliant he was as a flyer. Occasionally, they go up above the storm. And at that time, Warner cakes to the radio with his Morse code, and he sends messages to the world.
The moon shining down is casting our shadow into the clouds. The burning contents of the Fokker's exhaust pipe, a livid trail of flame spitting from the big blue monoplane as it tears over thousands of miles of ocean. There is no world. We were sailing lazily on the Milky Way.
All night in Sydney and Canada and America and England, people are sitting up with their crystal sets, and it becomes sensationally popular thing to do. Eventually, they get to what they hope is the Australian coast, and the excitement is unbelievable. Smithy comes in, surrounded by small planes, which give him an escort. And there they are. They've done it. Smithy just stands up and he looks at the crowd and he shouts out, "Hello, Aussies, my kingdom for smoke." He's charming and relaxed. They were like rock stars.
Smithy and his mother. What a happy meeting. She's one of the proudest Australians living.
All I want to say is that we expected him to do it and he's done it. He generally does what he sets out to do. Thank you all very much. Not like a
train. Kingsford Smith, Ulm and their crew had forged what would become one of the most important Australian connections of the 20th century.
Hoping to capitalise on their star power, Smithy and Ulm formed ANA, Australian National Airways. They had a grand vision for the future, a country connected by air.
Small airlines delivering mail and anything else they could fit between the passengers popped up all over the country. Like almost every Australian industry, aviation was mostly run by men. But flying would also become the obsession of young women like Nancy Bird.
She left school at 12 years old. They weren't wealthy. She was working for her dad's shop and she was putting all her money away at 15. She walked to Mascot Airport over a mile or something, and then she asked if she could learn to fly, and I think they said, "You're a little bit too young for that, thank you."
But Nancy Bird would not be grounded for long.
Okay.
In May 1930, a gypsy moth called Jason crossed the coast near Darwin. Its well-spoken pilot embodied a revolutionary idea.
1930 has been preeminently a year of women's exploits. Attempting to break Bert Hinkler's record, Miss Amy Johnson flew alone to Australia.
Amy Johnson was the first woman to fly from England to Australia, and she flew solo in just 19 days. She was only 3 days short of Bert Hinkler's record, a fact that dominated the front pages. At the time, roles for women were limited, but Amy showed how intrepid and rugged a woman could be.
She crash lands Jason her plane when she arrives.
I'm afraid that's the end of the Jason for a time.
Her jumper's ripped, her boots slashed.
Hello, everybody. I seem to have got here at last. It's been a long, long time, but here I am, and jolly glad I am to be here at last.
All Australia says good night to you, jolly aeroplane girl. Jolly aeroplane girl.
To greet Amy Johnson, there was even a guard of women pilots who actually accompanied her on a flight down to Sydney to let people know that it wasn't just Amy Johnson already in Australia. Women were up in the air. It was much more difficult for women because they didn't have the financial means to fly, but they were determined and they would find ways to do it.
Amy Johnson's feats didn't just break aviation records. They broke new ground for women. Suddenly women could see avenues for experience and for adventure that had never seemed possible before.
Women's wages were around 55% of men's, but increasing numbers of women had jobs. Nancy Bird wanted to fly for a living, and she had a plane with one spare seat.
At 19, Mum got her commercial license and she loved going to the country areas, and they would land the plane and they would take people up for joy flights. One show, she took up 101 people in one day. 101 flights in one day. Unbelievable.
Nancy's flying career would take her to Bourke in remote New South Wales, where planes were saving lives.
Mum was taking the nurse to people in the outback who were not able to get medical attention, or if somebody needed to be brought into the city for a hospital, she could be like an ambulance or the flying doctor service.
When the idea of the Royal Flying Doctor Service lined up with the pedal radio, together those two technologies made it possible for a whole transformation of Australians' internal life to occur.
Many Australians would look to the skies.
I always wanted to be a pilot, and there weren't any lady pilots.
For hope and new opportunities.
They weren't pretty, and they were a very bit mixed bag.
But as the 1920s drew to a close, crashes would rock Australia. The Wall Street stock market collapse in 1929 triggered the Great Depression. By 1932, Australian unemployment would hit 32%. But somehow, some Australian aviators stayed in the air. Just like Farlap and Don Bradman, Smithy buoyed the spirits of a depressed nation. His journey took just 12 and a half days from England to Australia. But like his country, Smithy was feeling the strain.
He talks openly about the panic attacks. He becomes very ill in the air. He thinks he's going to pass out. There's just so much a fly can take, and they crack up. This was known, the fires did crack up every now and again, and Smithy's got it.
But I'm not the only one that's flying from England to Australia at the present moment. You're making a wonderful fuss of me, and I do deeply appreciate it. But let us think sometimes of those chaps that struggle on and met with a little bit of misfortune. I've had lots of good luck. Anyway, it's awfully nice to hear you say nice things about me, as long as my girl says keep on saying them, because she'll realise what a fine fella she's got. She doesn't do it.
A fortnight later, tragedy struck Smithy and Olm's airline ANA. The Southern Cloud, with eight people aboard, disappeared. The loss shook people's faith in aviation.
And so many of his comrades made Australians fearful of flight. So in 1936, Holyman Airways devised a cunning strategy. They employed Australia's first air hostesses. After all, if a girl's happy to fly, it must be safe.
Matron Holyman, she was, I suppose, looking for someone who was sensible, could talk to people. They weren't pretty, and they were a very bit mixed bag.
It is essential to keep the uniform in an impeccable condition. The cap is extremely important. Worn like this, it looks absurd.
I always wanted to be a pilot, and in my day, it was still very expensive to be a pilot, and there weren't any lady pilots.
I was doing secretarial work, just shorthanded typing. It's pretty dreary. And this was a change, so I took that.
The early hostesses, most of them were nurses, because all the early planes were unpressurised, which meant you had to fly below 10,000 feet, and that meant you didn't fly above the turbulence, you were in the turbulence. So people were basically rocketed through the skies, thrown all over the place, and it was pretty rough and ready.
It is not good to turn a passenger's distress into dramatic entertainment for others. The airsick passenger is a case for quick, unobtrusive attention.
She was a lovely lady, and she got sick on the aircraft. I had to get the tongs and get the teeth out of the sick bag with the tongs. I was nearly throwing up. And then I had to take wash them and give them back to the... I gave them to her on a tray, a silver tray with a doily and the teeth on there.
Most young women's prospects were marriage and motherhood. Few would ever have the opportunity to travel unchaperoned. So the independence of air hostessing was intoxicating.
This was a job where you could actually escape from the pimply boy next door, and you could get on a plane and you could fly across the country. This was not something for the everyday Australian girl.
The last lap of a round-the-world flight, her plane comes down in the Pacific.
On the 150th anniversary of British colonisation, Aboriginal Australians marked a day of mourning.
Right from the early 20th century, there was a move to, if you like, swallow up Aboriginal people, make Aboriginal people disappear. Assimilation, it was basically a policy of we will breed them out, and that was the removing of the kids. They were not to go back into contact with Aboriginal communities again, who would wither away and die on the vine.
But in Arnhem Land, one Balinda, or white man, helped Yolngu resist assimilation. Missionary and engineer Harold Shepherdson.
He was the first Balinda contact during my time, when I was growing up, little boy, around a place called Buninyongwar, Buckingham Bay. My family and I lived there.
Harold Shepherdson wasn't just interested in spreading the gospel or whatever they thought that they were doing. He was interested in allowing the Yolngu to stay out on their own country. And to do that, to provide them with emergency backup if they need it, he needed a plane. It was just the basis of his outstation work.
It was very unusual for people who were working out in those communities as missionaries to actually conceive that there was a value in keeping Aboriginal people on their country. In fact, it would be highly unusual that they didn't have views around assimilation.
Now, the mission didn't have very much money and very little imagination. So he sent to America for plans and he proceeded to build this plane under his house. As you do.
Shepherdson would fly Yolngu around their country for more than 40 years.
A smoke bar, isn't it, to indicate wind direction for landing.
One of his later trips was captured on film.
The only transport I ever travelled in was airplanes. And there was nothing over the top of us. I just open air flying.
He could take out goods for them, he could bring back things that they wanted, and if necessary, he could evacuate anybody who was sick which is almost impossible in Arnhem Land without a plane.
Aviation had begun to change lives in every corner of the country. And it was about to unleash ordinary Australians on the world in new ways.
It was good looking and smart.
I didn't think about being sexy or anything like that. I was just happy to be flying.
Flying boats offered all the comforts of a large ship, combined with the speed of 1930s air technology. Travellers would recall this period of luxury and modernity as aviation's golden era. When it took 6 weeks by ship, the flying boats needed just 10 days to get their passengers to the centre of the British Empire.
It's an imperial world and a British world that aviation is taking place in. Most people who were living in Australia had either been born in Britain or their parents had been born in Britain. So Australians across these decades felt simultaneously Australian and they felt British.
The fast flying boat connection to Britain was beyond the reach of most Australians.
A one-way ticket in 1938 was comparable to about a year's wage. So you're looking at, say, $80,000 to $90,000 in today's money to fly one way from Sydney to London.
But some Australian battlers did get to fly to the UK. The stewards, all men.
Well, they put me into a training school and taught us how to serve a cup of coffee. I was good looking and smart. If I came from Newtown, in the early days, it was a pretty tough suburb until I'd become one of the mob. Have a couple of fights, make sure you won them.
They were sort of knockabout characters, stewards. I think because they had to be a sort of jack of all trades, go into the bow of the aircraft, hook the mooring.
Row a boat out to the flying boat, and they were good-natured blokes who knew about service. It was a bit of a boy's own territory, but it was fun.
Strange name for an Empire flying boat, Coolum Gatta, but she's for service at the Australian end of the Empire Air Route.
Oh, that was the most exciting thing. Get on a plane and you fly off like a pelican, the water gushing up the sides.
Vilma Jackson was 11 when she flew with her mother and sister to be reunited with her father, a banker working in England. I would imagine it would have been quite scary.
No.
No.
Definitely not scary.
She would be one of the last witnesses to a kind of air travel that's almost unimaginable today. The airlines promoted the sightseeing opportunities in advertisements.
Getting up out of his chair, a passenger could stroll along to the smoking cabin for a smoke. Stopping on the way at the promenade deck, with its high handrail and windows at eye level to gaze at the world of cloud and sky outside.
Yeah, they weren't encouraged to walk around the aircraft, though. Because they're getting in the bloody way.
Looking out the window and watching people down. I can remember a lady in the paddy fields picking up her daughter and showing it, just waving to us. You know, here now you just see clouds.
That's right, you're so disconnected from the land.
Waikato, Surabaya, Singapore, Bangkok, we saw the world.
From the air.
And on the ground. That's the wonderful part, that you land and go to a hotel and you sightsee. No, I think my days were good.
But not long after Vilma splashed down in England, the graceful flying boat connection with Australia was cut.
It is my melancholy duty to inform you officially that in consequence of a persistence by Germany in her invasion of Poland, Great Britain has declared war upon her, and that as a result, Australia is also at war.
Australia joined World War II as a loyal member of the Empire, and it expected the Empire to defend it, particularly against Japan.
Fear of nearby regions was at the heart of the Australian imagination, and part of Australia's obsession with remaining in the British Empire is the fact that Britain has the most dominant naval fleet in the world.
But this war would be different. It would be fought at the speed of aeroplanes. In 1941, Japanese forces advanced down the Malay Peninsula towards the crucial British naval base of Singapore. Australia's civilian flying boats were pressed into war service.
The RAF at the start of World War II was in one god-awful mess, really. The government basically said, we need those aeroplanes to bring people back out of war zones.
Unarmed Qantas crews flew hundreds of flights into Singapore to evacuate civilians.
All other aircraft had abandoned Singapore, it was too dangerous. But you had to sneak in the afternoon, stay overnight in the dark, and then take off the next morning. There were Japanese patrols everywhere in the air. They were bombing Singapore daily. When the fellows coming in got the radio signal, hey, we're under attack, they'd just slide into little harbours off islands and wait it out. And somebody could fly almost right over the top of you and not see you. When radio came through to say, at Singapore, the air raid's off, they'd take off again and go in.
Leaving Singapore on February the 3rd, 1942, flight steward Charles Barron wrote, "We can help no more." Within days, Singapore fell, and 15,000 Australians became prisoners of war. 4 days later, Japanese bombers attacked Darwin, killing more than 230 people. The dream machines had become the stuff of nightmares. Australia's Prime Minister John Curtin made a decision that would have consequences far beyond the war. Without any inhibitions of any kind, I make it quite clear that Australia looks to America, free of any pangs as to our traditional links or kinship with the United Kingdom. For the rest of the war, Australia would be America's base for the fight back against Japan. A million US servicemen and their war machines passed through the country and opened new horizons to Australians. The solitary female aircraft engineer at Brisbane's Archer Field Airport was Connie Jordan.
Connie Jordan was a Queenslander, school teacher, with a fascination for mechanical things, just was intrigued by this growing interest around Australia in aviation. She became an air mechanic for Qantas, and she was so good at her job that by the time that the Second World War broke out, she was most highly regarded. In Connie's case, her skills shone through, but she still had an enormous battle.
Connie became the first engineer at Archer Field qualified to work on American Lodestar planes. But when the bosses put her in charge of the Lodestar team, the men walked off the job.
And the union man got up on a ladder and he said, well, he said, I'll tell you what I'll do with you. He said, if any of you guys has got a license to fix the Lockheed Lodestar, please step forward and you can have the job. And of course, no hands went up and nobody stepped forward. And he said, well, until that happens, she's here. So they all went back to work.
At the end of the war, flying boats returned to Singapore. They were there to bring home the first of the Australians who'd been imprisoned by the Japanese 4 years earlier.
Australian prisoners at Singapore had been brutalised beyond description. It was going to be a great shock for the Australian population to see those people. But Australia was very curious. They'd heard horror stories.
It's a great and joyous day for Sydney and for all Australia when eight Catalina flying boats bring back the 1st 8th Division AIF prisoners of war from Singapore. 60,000 people crowd the foreshores of Rose Bay.
For the first time, Australians welcomed their returned men within a few weeks of their war ending.
Men of the 8th Division, and remembers amidst its joy the tragic number for whom there is no return.
What they learned from the former prisoners would shape Australian attitudes to Japan for decades. In peacetime, more Australians would take to the sky.
Some of these people didn't have anywhere to leave their animals. They just brought them with them.
Aeroplanes would spark new dreams and nightmares.
Finally, Mrs. Petroff was pushed into the plane.
In the late 1940s, after two world wars and the Depression, many Australians enjoyed peace and prosperity.
Production of this car is a triumph for Australian industry.
New cars, new homes, new gadgets, and for some, first flights on planes like the DC-3, larger, faster, and requiring new skills of their crew.
So Joan, tell me, what is this?
This is a wobble board, flat on the top and curved underneath, and part of our initial training. Now you put your feet on either side.
Okay, I'll give it a try.
But while carrying a cup of tea.
Oh, well. I'll try getting on first. Like this?
And it was to simulate the movement of a DC-3 in flight.
Okay.
When there was turbulence. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Whoa. Oh, I'm spinning. Yes.
I'm glad I got it.
Yeah, see how you go.
Oh. How do I look?
You look pretty good. You passed.
Oh.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
It's a very different feeling flying in one of these. It's quite noisy, but it's really comfortable.
It's a lovely aircraft, and that's what's important for the customer, who was sometimes a little bit scared.
Of course.
We did a lot of country runs out of Adelaide, out of Melbourne, out of Brisbane, and all through the Riverina, and we were up and down like a yo-yo, with about five different stops between Sydney and Melbourne. A lot of them had never flown before, and many of them was the only flight they ever did in their entire lifetime. Some of these people didn't have anywhere to leave their animals. They just brought them with them. Kids bringing their frogs, iguanas, they were all right. They just sat up in the luggage compartment.
As planes like the DC-3 changed life within Australia, Qantas's new American-made Constellations would open up international travel. And in the aisles of the Constellations began an epic struggle for equality in the skies.
Only domestic airlines had hostesses. Australia's international routes were staffed solely by men. But with the new Constellation came the Qantas Hostie. More than 1,000 young women applied, and only 9 were chosen.
I was very lucky to get in, I think. I was very fortunate. I was very naive and wondered what the heck had struck me, but the crews were all beautiful. And there was only one girl and 9 men on the plane. The Qantas Qantas uniform I liked. Its summer dress was a white shirt mega dress with gold buttons. It was quite an attractive uniform.
None of them were really outstanding looking girls when I think of it.
I didn't think about being sexy or anything like that. I was just happy to be flying. I was a bit of a tomboy, actually.
The stewards were on board to serve the food and the drink, and the air hostesses came on to do the practique, which is kind of getting all the paperwork done, but also to be very much the hostess, kind of sit on the edge of the seat and assure the passengers that everything was all right.
But then my job was to get around and talk to the passengers and make out that they want something that they don't want anyway.
The men had been there for 10 years. They were very happy doing the job, and suddenly these young, attractive, educated young women were on board and kind of just moving into spaces they didn't really want them to be in.
Male stewards also enjoyed better wages and conditions than their female colleagues. The women would fight for over 40 years for equality. The Constellations flew over an increasingly tense world.
Patterns of tracer rockets crisscross the impressive and symmetrical atomic cloud formation.
Today they are taught to wave the hammer and sickle of communism.
Australia was an enthusiastic, if distant, US ally in the Cold War against the Soviet Union. But a crucial clash between Cold War spies would play out in Australian skies. The Petrovs walked their Alsatian Jack in Canberra's Tilopia Park. But they were no ordinary dog lovers. The park was a drop-off point for stolen secrets, well known to Australian spy catchers at ASIO.
Husband and wife, Vladimir and Evdokia Petrov, were working as diplomats and spies for the Soviet Union. In April 1954, Vladimir defected. He didn't tell his wife.
Soviet officials placed Evdokia under house arrest before sending her to Moscow.
Here she comes, a Russian courier holding her by either arm, and a large and irate crowd following. Many of them were immigrants from communist countries.
Joyce Ball was the hostess on board.
We saw this poor woman being dragged across towards the aircraft.
Mrs. Petrov was being apparently forced to board the plane.
She came down to the ladies' lounge and she was crying. She said, "I think my husband is dead. She said, we killed him." And I said, "Mrs. Petrov, we can't do something to help you." She said, "No one can help me. Those two men with me have guns." So, of course, I went back and told the captain.
The pilot passed Joyce's tip to ASIO. When the flight landed at Darwin, they were waiting.
When we arrived, Mr. Layden, the acting administrator, said, "Mrs. Petrov, I wish to offer you asylum in Australia."
The scenes from the airport does something to Australia's consciousness of what stakes it was playing with in a global game.
The Petrovs' defection and the secrets they revealed allowed Australia's allies to bust communist spy rings around the world.
You can buy one ticket for luxury travel to practically every country in the free world.
Australia would use international air routes to build new, potentially profitable relationships. Once a feared enemy, Japan was now a growing market for Australian goods. In 1958, Qantas launched the Cherry Blossom route to Tokyo. On board, its first foreign air crew.
According to the manual, greet passengers in full uniform, which is hat, white gloves and uniform. Then after takeoff, immediately go to the toilet and change to kimono. Within 5 minutes' time, we just come out.
But the bitterness of war with Japan lingered. In Sydney, the Japanese hostesses stayed in cheaper hotels than other crew.
So we wrote a letter and crew supervisor, and why we can't move to our own company's hotel, and they said, too good for you. Australian people, majority, they're very kind and it's very warm-hearted people. But sometimes, particularly Anzac Day, and we were told not to go out.
Australians' appetite for air travel continued to grow. They flew on increasingly sophisticated aeroplanes that they expected to be safe.
As aviation technology developed, aeroplanes themselves became safer, but they also became bigger, which meant that they could carry more passengers. So although the number of accidents often went down over time, the risk of more people being injured or killed in an individual crash actually went up significantly in the 1930s, again in the 1940s, and yet again in the 1950s.
In 1952, a string of disasters shook aviation around the world. Three British de Havilland Comets crashed, killing all on board. Baffled investigators called for help from global experts. One was Australian aeronautical engineer David Warren.
I kept thinking to myself, if it were a pilot error or if it were something which were known to the crew, they may have said something or done something. If only we could recapture those last few seconds, it'd save all this argument and uncertainty. We'd know what it was. Somebody may have known. And I had been just the week before to an instrument exhibition and seen this. Now, this is the world's first pocket recorder, if you like.
David Warren developed recorders that could reveal how and why a plane crashed. The black box. It captured data from instruments and recorded sounds in the cockpit.
8TR Binawara down, 8TR to 8SK.
In 1960, Australia became the first country to make flight recorders mandatory.
The last major civil aviation accident to occur in Australia was on New Year's Eve 1968, when a Vickers Viscount crashed near Port Hedland in Western Australia, killing all 26 people on board.
The Port Hedland crash sparked an inferno, but the black box survived. Investigators discovered that an entire wing had broken off in flight. One of many black box revelations that would help make flying the safest way to travel.
That's more than 50 years ago. So it's quite incredible to think that although there have been some smaller aeroplane crashes in that period, we've actually sustained an extraordinary record of safety in Australia.
40 years on from its dangerous, thrilling origins, aviation had touched almost every Australian life. But the vast majority of Australians had still never been up in the air. A new generation of aeroplanes was about to change that.
In 1959, Australia's first commercial jet aircraft swung into service. The 707 almost halved flight times from Sydney to London.
While still expensive, intercontinental air travel had come into reach for many more Australians. The jet had roared into our lives.
Next time, in the 60s, women fought their way to the front of the plane.
They put me in the ground school. They weren't going to let me get in an aeroplane.
Gay men came out first in the air.
They used to call the male flight attendants flying mattresses.
And ordinary Australians joined the jet set.
But in those days, we all wanted to get away from home and party hard.